So this is the last of the 12 lectures in this series. Everybody here is a familiar face, so glad to see all of you here. We've looked at, after we get through this guy, 11 different existentialist thinkers. And Marcel, this person that we're looking at now, he fits really solidly into this third wave that we've been talking about with Sartre and Camus and Simone de Beauvoir. So what I'm going to do with this discussion here is I will talk a lot about Marcel and his key ideas, but I also want to use it to kind of wrap up the series by pointing out where, you know, his focus coincides with this guy's theme, or he's criticizing this person over here. And he's a really good person for that because he talks about every single one of the people that we've looked at this entire year. He's also famous for coining the term existentialism, in French at least. The Germans had, you know, existence philosophy, and Kierkegaard had talked about whatever it is in Danish, I don't know how to pronounce it. That's a language that I wish I'd learned. But he's the one who comes up with existentialism, you know, an existentialist in French. So, predictably enough, after a while, he divorces himself from the term, you know, by the time that Sartre gets a hold of it. There's a lot of that in existentialism. Sometimes he called his approach philosophy of existence, which is still pretty close. Sometimes he actually did say existentialist. And more often, what he liked to be called is a Neo-Socratic or a Christian Socratic. And he saw himself as being like Kierkegaard in that way. So Socratic in the sense of, like, you know, questioning and engaging in dialogue. Christian, we'll talk about that in a moment. So he was really conversant with the works of Kierkegaard, Dostoevsky, Nietzsche, even more obscure guys like Shestov, Rilke. He actually wrote musical compositions later on to try to put Rilke's poems to music. He knows other people like Jaspers and Ortega, who we haven't covered. And he mentions Heidegger. So all those precursors he knows. And then he's very involved in the Paris scene. And the Paris scene includes the atheist existentialists like Sartre and de Beauvoir. And then when he gets there, Camus. They're really big on the scene, but it also includes these other lesser-known figures like Berdyaev, who's a Russian. A lot of Russian emigres going to Paris because they get kicked out of Soviet Russia. This guy Jean Val, and another famous philosopher, Paul Ricoeur, who's better known for hermeneutics and continental philosophy. They were all sort of in the same circle there. He also knew and was pretty involved with the circle that was connected with this guy Jacques Maritain. If you know much about 20th century Catholic thought, Jacques Maritain is one of the big guys. He ends up contributing to the UN Declaration on Human Rights, gets involved with that sort of stuff. But he was rather conservative in many respects. Marcel wrote philosophy, and if you've read any of his stuff, you'll notice that it's not your typical, now I'm going to treat this topic, now I'm going to treat this topic very orderly. He does essays and he strings them together and they sort of circle around the same sort of basic ideas, coming back to the same themes over and over again. He wrote journals. He, you know, only a philosopher would write something called a metaphysical journal. And that's what he found somebody to publish this, believe it or not. Can you imagine somebody trying to publish that now? You know, publishers, what are you talking about? What's really interesting, though, is that he wrote a lot of plays. And he wanted to be known for his plays. He was very disappointed that he was more known for his philosophy works than he was for his plays, because his plays are quite good. The Gabriel Marcel Society, which exists here in the United States, every once in a while will put one of them on. I'm not actually going to talk about them because I'm not that good at discussing philosophical drama. And he wrote so many of them that you know, you're going to find a lot of his themes in there. And then what's really interesting, this guy wrote music criticism. And towards the midpoint of his life, he actually started composing. He didn't compose until his wife convinced him to do so. shortly after the end of the World War. So he, what else do we need to say? He's a convert to the Catholic Church. He was raised an agnostic. He's a really interesting guy as far as intra-religious dialogue and debate goes on, because he doesn't like to debate. He has no interest in say, you know, philosophical arguments for the existence of God or apologetics or anything like that. He sees it as something that has to be intensely personal, that you can't coerce in any way. And we'll talk a little bit about how he brings in Christianity into his philosophy in a way that doesn't make it unphilosophical in a moment. He does get involved in these Christian philosophy debates. Well, this is one of the books I brought along. This is my one and only book so far. And it's not, it's mostly translations. And Marcel is one of the guys who has translated in here, because he wrote two articles in a journal for young people, the Nouvelle Revue de Jeunes, of Étienne Gilson's discussions of Christian philosophy. And the stuff that he says in there is pretty germane to what he's doing in other places. So I have a few things, you know, marked that I'll bring up. He ends up exerting some influence in American circles and British circles, I think in large part because his works are translated fairly early. He's seen as an important existentialist figure. A lot of people would say, well, you got your atheist existentialists, there's Sartre and Camus, and then if you want something theistic, you know, there's Marcel, and they would make it that stark. But he also gave the Gifford lectures in Aberdeen. And he gave the William James lectures at Harvard. And so if you do that sort of thing, that kind of puts you on people's maps, I think, as well. So what I'm going to do here, I'm not going to try to go over all of Marcel's key themes, because we don't have that much time. And I find it very difficult myself to hold all of his ideas in my head, because he's got so many of them. So what I'll do is, first I'll, you know, we'll go through his biography so you get a sense of where he fits into time. And then I'll talk about a few general features of his thought, and then we'll go to some of the main stuff. And what I want to do, I might skip over some of this. What I want to do is start with this distinction that he has between problem and mystery, because I think that's really helpful for understanding his thought. And then we'll look at this question of whether existence really is absurd, or whether it's maybe mysterious. And if we have time, we'll talk about Marcel's evaluation of other existentialists. And then that'll go into this discussion of the world of problems, which is a broken world, the world that we experience. He was very concerned with depersonalization, with the implications of modern technology and mass society. And then we'll start moving towards what's actually in the title, which I hope we do get to, which is Faith, Hope, and Charity, and how Marcel rethinks these. And just to give you sort of a little glimpse into that, when we think of faith, we often think of something like feeling or belief. You know, somebody has faith, it's about them and their comportment. He prefers the term fidelity. And fidelity is something that's less about what you believe about that, you know, thing out there, and it's more about how you comport yourself in relation to other things. So fidelity is actually going to be creative for him. He's going to rethink the notion of Christian charity or love or agape in terms of what he calls availability. It's a brilliant idea. And then he's going to talk a lot about hope. And he's probably one of the best people that I've ever found in discussions about hope. So those are some things to look forward to. So let's look at, you know, this guy's life, this biography. Like I said, he's raised an agnostic. He's born to this guy, Henry, and his mother, Laura. She dies very, very early in his life. He's only 4 years old when she dies. And his father remarries when he's about 9 years old to his mother's sister. And then soon after that, he's appointed the ambassador to Sweden. So they all go to Sweden. They go to Stockholm I think it's Stockholm, right? How it's pronounced. And he's there for about a year, and then he comes back to France. And Marcel has, I don't have a lot about his school years on here because, you know, he doesn't have a lot of issues during his school years. He's a really smart kid. You notice the times and dates on here. He begins to study at the Sorbonne and attends classes with Henri Bergson, who was a really major figure at that time, involved in the revitalization of French metaphysics. He begins to study with him at the Collège de France, so he's going, you know, to two different places. And he defends his dissertation at the Sorbonne when he's 20 years old. So you notice, 1889, 1909. And he writes on Coleridge. Now you might say, well, why Coleridge? Coleridge's not a philosopher. Well, Coleridge is actually how German idealism made its way into the English and the American scenes. Coleridge was indeed very interested in philosophy. The American Transcendentalist movement got their German idealism largely through Coleridge. And so he's writing on Coleridge, and he's writing on this guy Schelling, who is another major German idealist. And at that time, Marcel would describe himself as an idealist, in the sense that he thinks that thought is in fact what encompasses all reality. He obtains the agrégé in philosophy, which means he can teach wherever, you know, they find a spot for him. France, we've talked about this, France was very organized, let's say. That's probably the nicest word for it, in how they would dole out the jobs to philosophers or anybody else. So he begins to teach at lycées, you know, high schools. The French curriculum has philosophy within it. And he does that for a while. He goes to a private school near Geneva. And then the World War happens. And something pretty important happens with this Red Cross job, something that's going to change his orientation towards things. He begins working in a bureau which is dealing with MIA soldiers. And there were a lot of them at the time. And their families were, you know, understandably very upset. I mean, World War I was just a slaughterhouse. You know, you think about some of the great battles of it, like Verdun, that went on for months and just consumed hundreds of thousands of lives. And a lot of these lives, they didn't know whether these people were dead, whether they were, you know, out there in no man's land still wounded, whether, you know, what had become of them. And he does that until 1918, and he says that this is very important for him to sort of come to terms with how important the personal is. He becomes what we can call a personalist. Personalists in philosophy are people who think that what ultimately matters are persons and the relations that persons have to each other. That persons are radically distinct from things. Because, you know, if you think about just the work that's involved in trying to keep track of all these statistics and all these people, it's very easy to turn people into entries in a ledger sheet. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, we see this today, but this is a time where all of these things are very compressed because, you know, a war is still going on. So he's doing that. He begins to publish some of his first plays at this time, and he begins writing his metaphysical journal, which is really quite interesting stuff. He gets married in 1919, so he's 30 years old, and begins teaching as a professor, and that's not going to last very long. He's never had great health in his life, and he doesn't really enjoy academic teaching. He will have other teaching places, you know, temporary here and there, but he doesn't really enjoy that. He does like writing. He does like thinking. So he starts working for the Nouvelle Revue Française, which is a major journal at that time. And by 1922, he's quitting full-time teaching. And he and his wife in 1922 then adopt their son, Jean. They weren't able to have children. He begins writing for L'Europe Nouvelle as well. And now he's bringing out more and more things as well. And he writes this journal article in 1925, Existence et Objectivité. So just, you know, that's just Frenchifying existence and objectivity, right? And Kierkegaard really wasn't that well known in the French scene, but translations of his are coming out. And Kierkegaard is really a revelation to these French thinkers. Marcel is seen as was one of the people who's doing that introduction. Although, interestingly enough, later in his life, he'll say, you know, I actually never really read that much Kierkegaard. I just sort of had a lot of the same ideas as him, sort of like Lev Shestov. Lev Shestov, that Russian existentialist, he finds Kierkegaard in the 1930s. And then, you know, because people are saying, you know, you got to read this guy. He's saying a lot of the same things as you. Are you sure you're not copying him? And he reads him and he's like, oh, yeah, we have the same ideas. He starts attending Protestant services because he's now actively looking. His father dies in 26, and the Metaphysical Journal comes out in 27. In 1929, he converts to and becomes a Roman Catholic. And part of the story behind that is he's been writing all this stuff. He's been taking all these positions. And this guy... François Mauriac, I don't know if any of you know him, Nest of Vipers, that's his best-known work. Yeah. He was an important French Catholic thinker at the time. And I don't remember the exact details of this, but somehow Mauriac says to Marcel in a letter, why aren't you one of us? Why are you in that camp over there when your sentiments and the themes and all the things you say seem to fit so much better in with not the very dogmatic, you know, anti-modernist Catholics, you know, the sort of, you know, manualist, everything has got its place sort of Catholics. There's a lot of really brilliant, innovative Catholic thinkers in France from the late 1800s all the way through the 40s. And Mauriac is one of them. And Marcel says, yeah, I guess you're right. And so he decides he's gonna convert. And then, you know, for him that actually means getting baptized, because he was never baptized, because he was raised an agnostic. He starts hosting he gets involved in the Christian philosophy debates as a newly baptized Christian. And in 1933, he has this really important piece, which I forgot to bring along, unfortunately, the position et approche concrète du mystère ontologique, which means the it's often translated as the concrete approaches to the ontological mystery. And it's a piece that he presents at the Société d'études philosophiques de Marseille. There were two main philosophy, let's call them associations at that time. There's the Société Française de Philosophie, and that was based largely in Paris, and, you know, it's sort of like the American Philosophical Association today. You go there and you keynote, you've really made it, you know, only this is for French guys and it's a smaller circle. The Société d'études philosophiques was they were based in the South, which is where a lot of people, you know, who weren't all that they weren't that happy with them, and the Paris scene got banished to teach. And it included these really brilliant thinkers. And they'd get together every so often, and then, you know, somebody like Marcel would get up and they'd read a short paper and promote some discussion. And these were like the who's who of the French philosophical scene, at least the ones who were doing, you know, genuine philosophy. So this is sort of a turning point for him. That goes into this book, Being and Having, that he's going to bring out after that. And that's one of his first important philosophical works. And then you see, they just keep following over and over again after that. Now he sort of enters into the period where he's making it big. People are recognizing that this guy has a lot of interesting things to say. He starts hosting informal Friday philosophy sessions, starts teaching again, you know, here and there. And he brings out Creative Fidelity, Homo Viator. He brings out a book on the metaphysics of Josiah Royce, who he was very interested in as a student. Now, through the war years, he's doing this work. And then in 1945, like I said, he gets encouraged by his wife to start writing music. And he's been writing music commentary this whole time, but he's never tried, and he's played music, of course. He's never tried composing music. And he decides to do musical interpretation of poetry. And two of the biggest names in the group that he's doing that with would be Baudelaire, who's a really interesting French poet, and Rilke. So he's taking existentialist poetry and trying to turn it into music. I wish I knew more about music so I could tell you more about that, because it sounds extremely fascinating.
Have you heard it?
I haven't. And I want to track some of that down so I can actually...
Wouldn't that be great at the UUCC?
Yeah.
Like something like that.
Oh, yeah. You're talking about the talk in January.
Talk, yeah.
Sounds like Tone Row music or something. You know, Day Burn and Votzak and things like that. It's really hard to put together. They came up with this idea that you just have to use all 12 notes and then you... And sometimes it's a horn and a piano and a bass. And very strange.
It's a variation of the atonal stuff that Schoenberg gets started. And Schoenberg is influenced by existentialists.
I'm just wondering how you get philosophy into music. It would have to sound something like that, especially existentialism.
Yeah.
It's not going to be Debussy.
Well, you know, it could be, though, because Debussy is doing this stuff that's introducing dissonances at the right point.
There is melody there.
It wouldn't be Mozart. I'll certainly say that. Well, I mean, you could have melody. Existentialism doesn't necessarily mean that everything is without meaning. Marcel is going to talk about that in terms of mystery. Let's go on with this. So you see that he's the rest of his life, after his wife dies, unfortunately, he's going to be doing all sorts of, you know, trips, and he receives prizes all over the place, and he's bringing out more and more plays and more books. Now, a lot of these books... I don't want to say if you've read one Marcel book, you've read them all, because that's not the case. There are different emphases and different themes. But he is going to keep coming back to the same basic issues over and over and over again, like the problem, the distinction between problem and mystery, or his concerns about depersonalization of modern society, or you know, what we can get out of looking at things like faith and hope and charity. So let's talk about some of the key ideas of his philosophy. He says, I don't want a philosophical system. Why not? Not because philosophical systems are necessarily terrible, but because reality can't be encompassed by a system. And we already have enough systems in place. You know, if you think about our ordinary life, we have all sorts of systems.
Could it be that Sartre's being in nothingness was one of the reasons why he wanted to distance himself from systems and existentialism?
From Marcel?
Yeah.
No. Because being in nothingness is coming out long after Marcel has been active and formed his thoughts.
Yeah, he's much older.
Marcel, and I should say something about this, actually, as far as biography goes. If there was anybody who was Sartre's biggest enemy and Marcel's biggest enemy, it was those two guys. They would go to each other's plays and storm out. They criticize each other in their works. Marcel is the only person who Sartre, you know, for example, in Existentialism as a Humanism, names as, well, if you want to be one of those Christian existentialists who are totally wrong, you can take Marcel. So these guys, they're contemporaries. Marcel is not in any way derivative from Sartre. And Sartre isn't derivative from Marcel either. They're exploring two different views of existentialism. As a matter of fact, let me read you a passage from his... He's got this piece, Existence and Human Freedom, which is a whole critique of Sartre. And he says, I would suggest that existentialism stands today at a parting of the ways. It is, in the last analysis, obliged either to deny or to transcend itself. It denies itself when it falls to the level of infra-dialectical materialism. It transcends itself when it opens itself out to the experience of the superhuman, an experience which can hardly be ours in a genuine and lasting way this side of death. And he goes on. So Sartre totally rules that kind of thing out. For Sartre, this is it. And as we've seen, freedom means that I have to be totally free of everybody. The other is always a threat to me. This is very different than Marcel's philosophy.
Right, but yeah. I thought that the differences might have been sharpened by the publication of that work, because it seems like...
Oh, the differences, sure.
That's what I meant.
Yeah. I thought I was understanding you to say that perhaps some of his ideas have come from Sartre.
Yeah,
no,
that's what I
yeah, not at all.
Yeah, so no, his anti-systemization, I mean, Kierkegaard is anti-systematic, and Shestov, who Marcel has read, is anti-systematic, and it's part of the whole sort of existentialist package. If you claim to be a systematic existentialist, I think people will probably look at you very funny, you know.
Well, then how did Sartre view himself?
How does Sartre view himself?
He seems to have a system in being a novelist.
You can call it that. It depends. So what we're running into here is an equivocation on the word system.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
When I'm talking about system, I'm talking about something like Kant or like Hegel. Uh-huh. Sartre has a phenomenology, a sort of here's what we can actually see, and we're going to try to draw out the connections. But he thinks ultimately, in the end, it's a fragmented existence. We can't say anything about what your freedom is really going to look like, other than it won't look like that or that or that or that or that. That's not quite the same thing as, you know, being able to say, well, the apotheosis of world spirit lies in the Prussian state, a la, you know, Hegel. That there is a system, you know. You know, imagine trying to take being and nothingness and turn it into a program for education. Could it be done? I don't think so, because there are so many places where you'd have to say to the students, well, you know, you got to figure that out for yourself, right? So if there is a system, it's a system that undoes itself.
Yes.
Well, so let's go on. What is Marcel engaged in? He engages in reflection, and he distinguishes between what he calls primary and secondary reflection. So primary reflection is something that we do all the time. We run into the puzzling or the problematic. We run into things that we have to deal with, and we start thinking. This is what makes us human, you know, as opposed to, you know, a insect which will keep doing the same thing that it's programmed to over and over and over again, or, you know, even the higher animals that will do some measure of creativity but aren't particularly good at problem solving. We humans, we adapt to things. We start to think about how we can make sense of things. Primary reflection tends to be technical and analytic and external. It's not something that necessarily... It uses us, but it doesn't involve us personally in it. So my primary reflection could be the same as yours in solving a math problem, for example. It shouldn't make any difference that it's me that's solving it as opposed to you. Secondary reflection is reflection on reflection, and it takes into account how we're involved in the process and what we might be bringing to it and what it might be doing to us. So it's synthetic. It restores unity. It recuperates things. Marcel's is a great opponent of what he calls the spirit of abstraction. And one of his great quotes is, "Abstraction cannot remain at the stage of mere abstraction. It is just as if they took on concrete life, though an abnormal and unhealthy life, which we could properly compare to that of a cancer tissue." A lot of our experience of you know, alienation and not being treated as persons comes from being treated as abstractions that need to fit into whatever arrangements that or order that's in place. I mean, think about what it's like to go to the doctor and that experience of dealing with insurance stuff. That is something that we all relate to, right? And how, you know, a lot of times the person across from you is asking you for information, and you're like, none of this is relevant. Just get me into the doctor. I'm a person, you know. And the process can go on and on and on. I was talking a little bit earlier about how 2 summers ago I tore 2 ligaments in my knee, and it was in down at the beach in Montauk, so I had to go to the Southampton Hospital. And, you know, they took my insurance card, and they took my driver's license, and I almost left without them giving them back to me. I had to, like, you know, get quite emphatic to get them back. And then they were still sending us misfiled bills and things like that a year later. And we'd send them letters. No, this was paid. This was actually approved. I think a lot of you have probably gone through stuff like that. So that's, you know, that's an example of us running into abstraction. The spirit of abstraction is
bureaucracy.
Yeah, bureaucracy is one example of that. He actually mentions in one book that he would often tell his students in class that bureaucracy is necessarily inhuman. This is the sort of thing he'd say in his class to students. And he's saying this to French kids who, a lot of them are going to become bureaucrats, you know, because that's part of what the school system was about.
Marx talked about petty bureaucrats, and they all picked it up from the Russians.
Who picked it up from?
Well, a lot of the French philosophers. I mean, they were all, you know, moved by what Marx had to say, a lot of them anyway, maybe not the Christian ones.
Yeah, I don't think this has to do... I think this Marcel doesn't usually pick up, you know, so-and-so said it, so it must be true. He's looking at ordinary experience and then trying to make sense of it. Even if Marx had never written, I think we could still experience bureaucracy as dehumanizing. Now, what he wanted to do is he wanted to find the metaphysical depth that's been covered over or ignored in everyday experiences and try to describe it with ordinary language. He says, this is an interesting thing he says about language. He says, servitude to words is a big problem. The first mission of the philosopher is to refuse to accept that servitude. And then he says, Heidegger proclaims in his letter on humanism, when he says that language is a dwelling place of being, a fact which confers upon language a certain quality of sacredness. As far as Heidegger is concerned, I should note in passing, he himself risks damaging this special quality of language insofar as he does violence to language in not hesitating to coin words of which one doubts they will ever receive that patina which comes from constant use by many people over a long period of time. Then Marcel says, I think that philosophers ought not only to come back to the simplest words, but they ought to give these words a higher value by removing, as it were, the layers of grease with which they have become covered by impropriety and common speech. So, you know, he wants to try to express the experience that we're having as concrete individual human beings in the drama of life in which we're engaged, and to philosophize from that basis, what's really important.
Does his philosophy deal with such concepts as, say, the ground of being?
Yes. That's what we're getting to.
Oh, good. Okay.
So let's move on to talk about this issue of the problem and the mystery. So I've created a handout for you dealing with this sort of thing. And there's a lot packed in there. A problem is something that we all experience, we all run into. Mystery is something that would be connected with the ground of being. And which leads us there, and which many of the conditions of life and our own personal conditions often keep us from being able to even articulate, let alone to approach. And here we see a connection with thinkers like Kierkegaard and Rilke and Heidegger in talking about depth and what can't be put into, you know, a neatly systematized, organized thing that you just put into a handout and hand off, you know, off to people and say, here you go. There's kind of a connection with Kafka as well, in that Kafka is really writing a lot about dehumanization. He's not giving us any solutions, but he is, you know, sort of identifying the problem. And like he says, we can understand these in terms of philosophical problems, personal problems, technological problems. Problems all are things that have some sort, or they call for some sort of answer, some sort of remedy. We have a problem when we can reduce things to parameters that we can kind of place in front of ourselves. And then we can start to try to find some sort of technique, or he uses the word techniques, which not only includes, you know, like techniques, but also technology. A problem arises because of some need to address a matter, often through working with our affects of fear and desire. He says that problems, the world of problems coincides with the world of fear and desire. So we want to improve something, to make some things work together, to try to generate an adequate understanding of something or to arrange and to order things. And this is, you know, a very human thing to do, isn't it? And he says, a key characteristic of these is that they call for and they're grappled with by means of, say, disciplines or techniques or technologies. And those are appropriate to those problems. Now, do the things that we regard as problems, is that an adequate way of understanding them? Are they exhausted by that? Again, let's use the example of dealing with insurance and medical treatment. I can just put this to a poll. How many of you feel that the systems that we've got in place for paying for the medical treatment that we all have to get once in a while, that they really deal with the problem of providing us medical care, which is a separate issue of whether we're happy with them or whether they really satisfy us as persons. Just the issue of, do you get the care that you need by dealing with all this paperwork and letting those other people, you know, ask you questions and make phone calls and all that? Sometimes you don't even get that, right?
No. Money greases the wheels.
I think us being mostly over 65, it's not as bad. If you're asking a bunch of 40-year-olds, you know, it's really rough. And the payments they got to pay, the money, just ridiculous. And yeah, they'd have lots of complaints. But once you get on Medicare, you're kind of cruising.
Really?
It's not as bad as if you're 40 and you have to come up with that money every month.
That's kind of good to hear because you hear about, like, Medicare claims being denied.
I know someone in their 70s who has liver cancer in the home, in the apartment building. And there's a pill he could get. They're denying it.
Yeah.
Why?
He's fighting to get it. I think it's a very expensive.
That's basically.
Yeah, well, the richer you are or the poorer you are, the better off you are. But if you're in the middle, that's
right.
So there we see kind of a counterintuitive thing that gets generated by the way in which people try to solve the problem. Yeah. And a lot of times the efforts that we bring to try to solve problems generate new problems. Insurance is a great example of that. Our whole medical system is a good example of that. Now, you know, let's deepen the question. How many of you, when you have to deal with all this, you know, paperwork and cards, and you're being, you know, the first thing that they want to see when you go into the hospital is your insurance card, and they want to know your group number. How do you actually feel? You know, all of you remember times, and I even do, because, you know, I'm in my 40s, where going to the doctor just meant actually, like, first going in, and the doctor, like, looking at you and saying, what's wrong with you, and not asking for some sort of, you know, proof that you can pay right away. You know, one way you're being treated like a person, the other way you're being treated as a sort of assemblage of numbers or functions or something like that. And they'd like you to be nice and easy to deal with in terms of, better have that card out when you get in there, you know, make sure you've brought it along so that nobody has to go to any trouble. So Marcel is writing about this sort of thing. These are what he's calling problems. And he talks about the world that our human lives are, you know, stuck in as a world that's riddled with problems. And we can keep finding more and more and more.
So ennui.
Well, ennui is an affect that can come out of that. But here he's just talking about the actual experience of running into things, you know, of being able to look anywhere and see.
You become conditioned.
Dehumanized.
To be ready with that card, you become conditioned that this is the system, and what else are we going to do? So, you know, there is no answer to it anymore. As long as there is money in the system, as health is a money-making business.
Oh, that's a huge money-making business.
Then, you know, it's going to be dehumanized unless you're very rich.
It's reached the point where a good portion of our economy is actually things like healthcare, where we're not producing anything other than, say, health. From an economic standpoint, it's really quite strange, because large portions, you look at, you know, what stocks are actually valuable, medical company stocks. Large portion of the economy is devoted to all these activities of healthcare. And you would say, oh, that's a clear sign that this society really cares about people. And yet it's more dehumanizing now than it was when we spent, say, 5% of our GDP on that sort of thing. But let's go on. So we've got an idea of the problematic. He says, there exists in such a world an infinity of problems, since the causes are not known to us in detail and leave room for unlimited research. In addition to these theoretical problems, there's innumerable technical problems bound up with the difficulty of knowing how the various functions, once they've been inventoried and labeled, can be made to work together without doing each other harm. And you can have problems for, you know, how to deal with your personal life or your health. Or, you know, your car is a whole set of problems, as I'm sure all of you have experienced, you know. And for each of them, we have these remedies that we can bring up. And he says, another way that we can characterize this domain is that it's the realm of the objective. What is being treated as objects, even if it's the human subject. So when you're talking about being depersonalized, that's being treated as just an object. And in a lot of cases, in order to make matters intractable, the kind of techniques that we would want to use, you have to oversimplify. You have to leave the messy dimensions of things out so that things can have clean contours. Now, what he's talking about mystery, talking about as mystery, is not something radically different originally from problems. He defines mystery in terms of problem in two different ways. A mystery is what we call a meta-problematic, where the meta isn't just beyond or higher, but signifies taking a problem to a higher degree. So when we start to think about, you know, if we start to problematize insurance, we say, what the hell is wrong with us that things have gotten to this point? Now we're starting to engage in a meta problematic. We're looking at the way in which we've arranged the problem and the ways in which we're trying to remedy it, and then we're saying, is it really adequate to us as human beings? And we could, like, you know, do that and have a gripe session for a bit and then just bounce back down, you know. Or we can go further with it. A mystery is also, he says, a problem which encroaches upon its own data. Now, what that means is that there's certain problems or certain puzzles for us in which we are ourselves necessarily engaged, where we can't extricate ourselves from it. So a good example of this is anger management. When you want to do anger management, most people don't want to do anger management to begin with. So oftentimes anger management is actually, you know, court ordered, right?
Yeah, so, like the movie.
Yeah, exactly. there's something to that. But a lot of times anger management comes about through other people telling you, hey, you're a jerk. You need to, like, you know, deal with your temper, or we're not going to have anything to do with you. So it doesn't have to be the court. And you can go and buy books. There's actually an anger management workbook. I know, because I went and I bought it, and I didn't find it particularly helpful. And it's gone through a number of editions, you know. And you do these exercises and all that. And it's supposed to, like, you know, deal with your problem. Now, the book will only do anything for you if you go beyond the book. It can provide you with a useful set of tools for rethinking things. I didn't find it useful because I already knew intellectually all the stuff that it was telling me. It's really a question of, now here we get to the personal, am I actually going to apply any of this stuff when it happens? Like, you know, for the first lesson they teach you in that book is, as soon as you become angry, you become stupid. You may be a smart person, but you're going to start getting blinders, and you're going to do reasoning processes that are the reasoning processes of a stupid person. So you should be able to tell yourself that. And
that's what's happened with the police.
It could be, yeah. But that's a hard thing to do, to, you know, when you're in the situation, say, I'm starting to make stupid... No, instead, oftentimes you say, I'm being perfectly rational, it's the rest of them that are being irrational, and that's why I'm angry at them. And you come up with this entire narrative. Now, in order to make that actually work, you have to see yourself as being personally involved in it and as having responsibility.
That's true.
Yeah. So that's an example of something in which, like you're saying, the problem encroaches upon its own data because I'm part of the data. How I choose to see things is part of the data. That's what a mystery is. And there's a tendency, he says, for mysteries to get transformed back into problems because we're often much more comfortable with problems than we are with mysteries, because mysteries require us to have a certain openness, to not want the answers all at once, to develop a kind of patience, to realize that my understanding of it may not actually satisfy him or her. And that, you know, when we have a whole culture that militates against that sort of thing, it becomes much more difficult. So he says the ontological status, going to the question of depth, assumes of the investigator assumes a decisive importance. We can speak of personal solutions, not meaning that they're merely subjective, but that they do involve the person, and they can only be communicated to another person. They can be communicated through intermediaries, you know, like books, but it ultimately has to be a kind of personal appropriative reading. And I'll just give you some examples of mysteries that he brings up in his work over and over again. One is the problem of being. So this goes to that question of the foundation of things. And if I ask the question of being, what is being, like Heidegger did, I realize, as Heidegger did, that I'm the one who's asking the question. I am the being that is able to question being. And now if you start saying this to a lot of people, they get very uncomfortable. What the hell are you talking about? You know, and they want it to be put in terms of a problem. But if you do that, then you're going to start getting out of the mystery and the depths. Another one that he brings up a lot is the problem of evil, or rather the mystery of evil. He says, in reflecting upon evil, I tend almost inevitably to regard it as a disorder which I view from the outside and of which I seek to discover the causes or secret aims. Why is it that the mechanism functions so defectively? Or is the defect merely apparent and due to a real defect of my vision? In this case, the defect is within myself, but it remains objective in relation to my thought, which discovers it and observes it. But evil which is only stated or observed is no longer evil which is suffered. In fact, it ceases to be evil. In reality, I can only grasp it as evil in the measure in which it touches me. And so there's a tendency to want to turn, you know, our experience of evil into something that could be managed, that we could have a definition for. And we're not going to get that. Or we can supply those, but every time that we supply something like that, we're actually going off. We're getting away from what actually has depth. Yeah.
Could you say that his classification of problems basically are objective issues, and what he's calling mysteries are subjective?
Yeah, see that the whole division between objective and subjective is still at the level of problems. So he would say, as opposed to both of those, there's the personal. The subjective is not. When we talk about subjectivity, we often like imagine that there's this pure arbitrariness or something like that to it.
Yeah, but I mean he as you present it. Rails against the abuse of language, wants more simple language usage and more objective use of language. The way he uses mystery seems to be exactly the opposite of that.
No, I mean if you look at how the term mystery has traditionally been used, it's been used not for something that's, you know, I mean, we're not talking about like mystery literature. We're talking about, you know, sort of the theological use of the term mystery. Well, it means something that we can penetrate into, but something that has real being and can't ever be exhausted. It can't be reduced to the merely subjective. The world of sort of the objective can't adequately formulate it or see it.
Like prayer? Or why when Indians dance it rains and sometimes it doesn't?
Well, that wouldn't be a...
That's a mystery.
Well, yeah, but now we're using mystery in different ways. We want to get to the heart of this, right?
It sounds like he's using mystery in a Catholic sense, the Catholic religion. And many of the other ideas of his that you're presenting seem to fit.
He had this idea before he converted, actually.
That's what I was going to ask.
That's probably why he converted.
It may be, yeah. Yeah, I think, it's not just a Catholic thing. I mean, this is a Protestant, Orthodox. This is a across the board. If you read the early church fathers before, there's a division into, you know, different.
So it's a theistic thing.
Though. Well, and it also fits into Jewish thought, and it also fits into other religions' thoughts as well. I mean, he thinks that there's two things to be said. One thing is that it doesn't have a just religious significance. I think you're right. He's attracted to a religious point of view because he's got the metaphysics that then says this is what actually fits this, and this is what's going to take me further. And then he does seem to think that if one is going to just rule that sort of thing out because it's religious, one's cutting oneself off from an adequate understanding of the ground of being.
I think Jung wrote about that.
Who?
Carl Jung.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people are dealing with these same themes.
He called it the mysterium tremendum et fascinans.
Yeah. Yeah. There's. I mean, Rilke's talking about this, actually, when he talks about solitude. Yeah.
You know, when you put, you have the problem.
Yeah.
And then you add desire and fear. It seems to me you're talking Freud.
Well, you could be Freud, but it could be all sorts of other things. It's also Augustine.
No, but the point is, it seems rather, ironic, simplistic, I don't know what.
Yeah.
To be talking about the mystery of the human experience.
Yeah.
When we are subject to unconscious desires and fears, and that's a big mystery.
Yeah, so he thinks
that it's going to be, absolutely insoluble no matter what. Mm.
That may be, but that wouldn't affect what he's doing here.
No,
he sees the realm of desire and fear. And if you want to understand fear in a different way than he is, then you just got to sort of adapt that. But that's the superficial level. Maybe what when you're talking in Freudian terms, anxiety is closer to the kind of unconscious fear that we're talking about there. I mean, Marcel actually rejects psychoanalysis, so there's going to be a thing there because he thinks psychoanalysis turns the human being into a problem and doesn't recognize the mystery as well. But the mystery is the realm of hope and despair, and he thinks that these are deeper affects than fear and desire. Fear and desire can be dealt with in terms of the problem and in terms of developing techniques. If you think about why we develop all these techniques for things and disciplines, it's because we're motivated by desire and fear. And so you'd have no problem with, like, say, the Freudian notion of sublimization, things like that. But he just wants to say there's something deeper than that. And it can be brought to consciousness for Marcel.
Sure.
Maybe
you ought to talk about the fidelity, hope, and
charity.
Yeah,
we can jump to that if you want to. Yeah, I do want to say one thing though. He thinks that this world that we live in is in fact what he calls a broken world. So it's always our experience of it is always screwed up. Yeah, well, a lot of people don't think so though. A lot of people think it's a not a broken world at all. Things are great. Or they think that, well, there's just a few, things that need tweaking here and there. And if we just apply these techniques, it'll all turn out okay.
Who are these people?
Is that, you're talking about CEOs of General Motors that are on a yacht most
of
the year?
No, I mean people who go into the voting booth and think that, hey, because I pulled this lever, things are going to get radically better. I run into them all the time in academia. I can tell you that the academy is full of people like that. And a lot of our students would like the world to be like that because it's a hell of a lot more comfortable to feel like things are manageable, right?
Yeah, to think you have a tool here. A say,
Well, you do have a say. The only issue is...
Nobody's listening.
Well, it may be that nobody listens, and it may be that even if they listen, they don't help you out. We do have a say.
We don't really have a say about how it works.
Yeah,
we can choose the people we want, but then there's still that
We don't have the deciding voice.
The rules that the people we vote for have to follow, we have to change.
Yeah. I mean, if we talked about politics and even just like putting aside, you know, who ought to get elected or stuff like that, if we just looked at the current election processes and the way districts are apportioned, it's so demoralizing to look at and to think that it's supposed to be democratic.
Right.
Even just leaving aside who's right or who's wrong.
How would he feel about corporations being a person?
Well, he'd be totally against it.
He'd be against it.
I would think so.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting question to think about. And then we'll come to the Faith, Hope, and Charity. It's an interesting question to think about how Marcel might see the world that we live in. And I think that he saw after World War II that things had radically changed. He said, we're now living in an age that's very clearly that of mass society, and we have to be more careful, and there's more tendency to think that just by applying technology we're going to make everything better. And now we've reached the point where we're at the mercy of our technics, and we might destroy the whole thing.
And he's right.
Yeah. Now, is it worse now in some of these respects from a Marcellian standpoint than it was, say, in 1946? I think he'd say yes.
Mm.
And I think that he would say some of the things that we... First of all, he's not against technology per se. He says technology comes out of the gift of human reason and rationality, and we can apply it, and we can do really great stuff.
It almost worked till 1980.
What happened in 1980?
Everything went downhill, and it's been continuing in that direction.
Is that when they invented the internet?
No, I wouldn't blame it on the internet.
Well, so I was—that's one of the things I was actually thinking about.
But I mean, the economy and the jobs and everything was going up until about 80, and then it just went the other way.
Is that when they changed the tax bracket for the rich?
That might be it. That's probably it. In Eisenhower's day, the rich paid 80-something percent.
I think what you mean is in the 80s, that's when there are two...
Was that the Reagan era?
Yeah,
that's
Reagan,
right.
More or less.
Thoughts.
I didn't want to name them.
There's, you know, are we creating this society? And we need now have to say global society, because it has to apply to everyone if we're going to be all working together. For the human being first...
Yeah.
Or are we creating it so where the bottom line is, oh, you're going to die, but you see, we can't save you because our budget will not permit it. That's the other.
See, Marcel would say that trying to identify
that.
What was the tipping point or stuff like that, that's all still in the realm of problems. None of that gets to the mystery. None of that gets to what's personal. It just sort of circles around with, you know, let's provide another diagnosis instead of the diagnosis we've got.
So what about
he would say that things are worse, somewhat. It's a more broken world today than it was. And he'd say that 1980 and 1970 were more broken than 1960, too. It's not just about income equality or stuff like that. Every time that we try, from a Marcellian perspective, every time that we try to say that's really the key thing, we're still just dealing with a problem. We're not dealing with.
So any solution eventually goes back to the problem.
Any solution requires us to start actually looking at things in terms of these hard to assimilate personal realities that would have to put limits on our problem solving. And we're terrible at that. And we're worse now, I think, than ever, because, I mean, we live in a situation where one of the things he talks about, and there's a great quote in here, is his concern is about those who use a technology. Here we go. He's talking about means and ends. A technique for the man whose task is to invent it does not present itself simply as a means for a time at last. It becomes an end in itself. Since it has to be discovered, it has to be brought to being. And it's very easy for that to become our mindset. The other thing is he's very concerned about human beings using technology who didn't have any role in having to develop it, because it means they don't have to adapt themselves to it. They can approach it as pure consumers. And now it'd be silly to say, well, I can't use my iPhone until I've been a developer or something like that. But he says we ought to
have a more understanding of it.
We ought to be on guard against our tendencies to like think that technology is like totally enhances our abilities. You know, one of the reasons why productivity hasn't gone up dramatically with the internet is because people spend so much time having to screw around on the internet.
At their job place.
Yeah, and it's not just like they're Facebooking or something like that. The technology is constantly breaking down. I use Apple products, and Apple's supposed to be this, we'll take care of it all for you. And I think twice a week at least, I have to go into Apple forums and try to figure out why this thing that's supposed to be working this way isn't working this way. And it's all mostly amateurs writing about what they did to try to fix it, because the Apple Corporation isn't fixing it.
That's right.
You know? And you know, this is like our ubiquitous circumstance. Anyway, let's talk about faith, hope, and charity. So
that we're bombarded with so much information.
Oh, that's a problem too.
Different ideologies and everything. How can we solve the problem?
We don't. That's the issue. We don't solve the problem.
I guess I still don't understand what mystery is.
Well, that's okay. Maybe it'll get more.
Mystery.
A mystery is. Like you said, a problem that where we realize that we as persons are involved in the very way the problem is set up, is arranged. It's not something that has a solution.
Right. Okay.
So once you acknowledge that we are a part of it, becomes the mystery, but it's still not.
Well, that's
resolved.
How we open ourselves up.
Say?
To the mystery is there. So other examples of mysteries would be love. You know, you're not going to turn.
I mean,
love.
Some people will just see it as a problem. Okay, a problem, but I have nothing to do with it. It's not. I have no. You know, I'm not involved in this. So, you know, that's just my problem. But other people look at it and see that. Well, this could be. You know, they start to see it, so that becomes the mystery, but with no solution.
Well, mysteries don't have solutions. Mysteries just problems have solutions, and sometimes they're lasting solutions, and sometimes they're not. You know, mysteries are realities that we're allowed to, or if we want to, we can enter into and explore. The relation, here's another example, classic philosophical problem. What's the relationship between the mind and the body? He says, that's not actually a problem, that's actually a mystery. And you're not going to get to, no matter how much neuroscience you do, the neuroscience will tell you all about brain states, still won't tell you how we have consciousness, you know. And there may be a whole bunch of other problems that Marcel himself didn't think of because they weren't available in his time, but I think he's outlined a lot of them. But let's talk, since we don't have that much time, about faith, hope, and charity. So let's start, actually, instead of starting with faith, let's talk about charity. He's not going to talk much about that term. He'll talk a lot about love. But the word that he uses the most often is a French word that's hard to translate, disponibilité. And it gets translated as availability, and its opposite then would be unavailability. Sometimes it just gets transliterated into disposability and non-disposability. I've seen people translate it as handiness and non-handiness. But the basic idea is that when we're loving towards another, we place ourselves at their disposal. And when we place ourselves, there's ways we can do it. We can say, this far and that's it. I have these resources and I can't give you anything more. Or we can do it, you know, without putting that limitation on it. And there may be some cases where we simply can't give to everybody, and he's perfectly willing to recognize that. But there's this openness or lack of openness. He also talks about it in terms of presence. There are people who can be in the same room as you, and you can tell they're not present to you. Mm-hmm. You know, you tell them, hey, here's a great example. I'm going to use a very personal example that just happened this last week. We had to put a cat to sleep, a cat that my wife has had for 12 years and rescued as a kitten along with her sister. And she's loved her very much for years and years and years. And there's, you know, as many people who have to make that sort of decision do, there's a lot of second guessing that goes on, a lot of, oh, I should have done this at this point, you know, feelings of frustration that turn into feelings of anxiety and guilt. And if you look at it solely as a decision-making problem, it's got pretty straight parameters. The cat's probably not going to get better. You can assess these things in terms of not, you know, hard and fast probabilities, but fairly open probabilities based on what the vet says and based on the age of the cat. But that doesn't actually address what the loving owner. It would address what, like, a, you know, I've got this animal here just for reproduction purposes, you know, kitten mill owner would do, right? They just, all right, we're putting the thing to sleep now, right? But the loving cat owner, all these other things are being taken in there. And if you want to be loving to that person, one thing that, you know, is not going to work is saying, look, you just need to make a decision, you know, put your feelings aside. What would be best for the animal? And this may, in fact, what would be best for the animal, too, in many respects. Just look at it with cold, hard rationality and shut up about all this other stuff, right? Now, is that being available to...
No. Certainly.
Yeah. And even our availability to the animal itself is, you know, is affected by that, you know. And so...
It's very difficult, because then you also have to worry about, depending on your situation, the economic, and it's very expensive. And
yeah.
Some people have to say, you know, and I love you, but I don't know that I'd be spending on all of that on myself.
Yeah, and then and then people feel guilty about making a decision that includes that. Oftentimes people will mistake making a decision that includes economic components with making a decision solely based on economics. So they're doing this over here, which is laudable because it's good to take into account reality, and they treat themselves as if they're just reducing it to economics, and then they feel bad as a result. And so all of this is about, you know, whether you can be present to another. And I got to say that the vet and the tech that we dealt with, at least one of them, very, very good. Very available in this Marcellian sense to my wife. One of the other vets, really just a person who, not so available. I won't go into any details about that. I'll just say, you know, this is something that really exhibits what Christians call charity. Marcel is rethinking this concept in terms of availability. He talks about this as making room in oneself, in one's time, in one's attention, in one's resources. And it's connected with, you know, ideas like service or hospitality or love. And there is a affective component to it, but it's not reducible to this. So that's why we can continue to have this openness even if we don't really want to. You know, it can be an act of will. And then he's talking about non-availability. So where does our lack of this come from? He says, as my life becomes a more and more an established thing, a certain division tends to be made between what concerns me and what doesn't concern me. A division which appears rational enough in the making. We can all relate to this, right? Some things are just not our business. Each one of us thus becomes the center of a sort of mental space, arranged, we could say, in concentric zones of decreasing interest and decreasing adherence. And to this decreasing adherence, there corresponds an increasing non-disposability. This is something, he says, so natural that we forget to give it any thought or representation at all. It's part of what happens to us in life. You know, you couldn't function if you were available to everybody all the time. You would go nuts. And you'd be so taken advantage of that it wouldn't work. So this is, we develop, you know, some people talk about this in terms of like a shell, right? Or, you know, Reich, if you want to do psychoanalytic theory, body armor, you know. the very body itself becomes our armoring for this. But we often have encounters with other people where we get shocked out of this. You know, our tendency is to have availability only for those who are very close to us, and the rest of them, as they go further, forget that. You know, they don't need it. They don't deserve it. They got other people to take care of it for us. But then we run into the vulnerable other, and sometimes we melt a little bit.
Even Scrooge got converted.
It took a lot for him. Yeah, it wasn't on the first, I suppose in a lot of cases, depending on how hardened we are, it requires a lot.
Well,
go ahead.
Then it sounds like he viewed charity as something personal between
yes.
individuals
yeah. yes.
and charity in the sense of what many people in religions believe, that one has a moral obligation to provide some portion of what he has to those who have greater need.
That is just a subdivision of charity.
But
the virtue of charity is what should be motivating that duty. And the duty is lesser than the virtue.
Well, I think that's very important, because if the view of charity is simply interpersonal, then the view of government is likely the same way, rather than considering the need on a moral basis for governments to take care of the needs of people who can't provide for themselves.
Yeah.
Rather, government is designed to simply create rules for people's taking care of themselves, or the government taking care of them.
Well, I mean, Marcel wouldn't have a problem with what the Europeans call this whole thing that we call welfare, social security, and he wouldn't have a problem with that. What he would have a problem with is how bureaucratic it becomes. And just because something has interpersonality to it doesn't mean it's purely interpersonal.
Okay.
It would have political consequences. And it just means, though, that when if I'm the clerk and I'm dealing with cases, I don't get to just sort of, you know, stamp the things and get in, get out, that sort of thing. Treating people sort of like in a production process.
So he would allow more discretion?
Yeah. And discretion is always personal.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, in today's day, we talk about we are all connected.
We talk a lot.
I mean,
we talk about it,
but in reality, we are.
Oh,
it's
always possible for us to act otherwise.
Yeah, but if
and most
some
of us do.
Some people who want to help other than maybe their family and things like that, they see other people as part of their family. There are people who see other human. Oh,
hey.
It's so good to see you. I'm so sorry. I mean, that's how I feel.
Yeah.
I mean, that's where speciesism comes in.
I mean, we can do that. We don't have to have the model of familial relations, because then, you know, we might end up excluding people some other ways. Marcel is not trying to be prescriptive about how we have to do this. He's trying to show us what oftentimes gets covered up. But let's look at how this unavailability, he tells us about some of the ways these things get covered up. One is by treating everything as just a problem. If we're treating everything as just problems, we cannot be available to other people in the way that charity would require. He also says that unavailability always involves some kind of alienation. So he would not say that the kid who's been abused and has had a very difficult time forming attachments to other people, because, you know, the lesson that he's learned in foster home after foster home has been people are terrible and out to get you. He wouldn't say, well, that kid is held to the same standards of charity as somebody who came from a loving home and had good models about how to, you know, reach out to other people or things like that. But, you know, the reaction there is not to say, well, that kid gets a pass. Then the reaction is, wow, that kid's got it really bad, and they're not able to even be in touch with what it means to be fully human, and I feel bad for them, and I wonder if I can help them in any way, and maybe I'll reach out to them. And then the kid, of course, is probably, screw you, you know.
Right.
Yeah, like the first 30 times, right? But availability, in part, means accepting the screw yous of other people when it happens.
We're moving more toward being more charitable.
Do you think?
As a society?
We
have, like, Gates and Warren Buffett and all the millionaires pulling together to, you know, reach out to the poor or the ones that are disadvantaged.
I would disagree with
I don't see it myself.
Yeah, that's a drop in the bucket compared to the other side.
And just
it's greed and everything else.
Having a few representative individuals They're not the stand-in for the other persons in society, though. I think as our economy worsens, and it's been worsening for a long time, Marcel would say that there's a tendency for us to, you know, sort of focus in on ourselves and focus on self-preservation and preservation of those who are close to us, and to harden towards other people.
Like Tea Which Party is, politics?
Like Tea Party politics, but also like a lot of the left's politics,
yes,
as well.
Really?
And a lot of the people in the center, too. I don't think that this is something that... I think it's a mistake to try to identify this with one movement or
another. Oh, no, I'm just saying that's an example.
Well, I know a lot of Tea Party people who are jerks, and I know a lot of Tea Party people who are great people and who are charitable. And I can say the same thing about people in the unions.
And Democrats and Republicans.
Yeah, yeah. Right. So, it's, you know...
The bottom line is, the human species, we need each other.
Well, we
do. Just like we need animals, just like we need the earth. We need each other, and we have to start looking at it on that level. And things like Gates and all of these rich people are showing, at least becoming models to help us look at other people as equal as we are, just because they didn't have the same kind of opportunities.
Yes, I mean, Gates forced through education reforms in a totally undemocratic way that a lot of people are very angry with. I don't see him as the model. As Marcel wouldn't see him as the model.
Oh, I'm just talking about what his aim is.
Yeah.
And maybe his process wasn't, but sometimes in this world,
he's not perfect, but he helped with AIDS, he helped in Katrina, he helped in a lot of things. So anybody that does stuff like that, they get an applause from me. I mean,
that's not perfect.
Well, that's fine. I mean, that's we're getting very far away from what Marcel is telling for.
Okay.
So that's not disposability. That's just, you know, he's got plenty of money, so he uses it, and we say these are good things, but that's not this personal thing. And you can create, you know, you can throw millions of bucks at something and never actually engage with a real person. You know, a lot of times people use money as a way to,
yes,
to not do that.
Yes.
Let's go on to hope now. So he talks about hope as being in a zone beyond fear and desire. And its opposite is not fear, the way that some philosophers like Spinoza would say, you know, hope and fear are the opposites. It's despair. And when we're in the realm of just fear and desire, we're still in this realm of things could be solved, things could be fixed. We can know that. He says that at the root of hope is the consciousness of a state of things which invites us to despair. To hope is to put one's trust in reality, to assert that it contains the means of triumphing over this danger. And here it can be seen that the correlative of hope is not fear. Far from it, but the act of making the worst of things, a sort of pessimistic fatalism which assumes the impotence of reality, or which will not grant that it can take account of something, even if it is not just our good, but rather, as we think, a good in the absolute sense of the word. And then he says, it always has to do with the restoration of a certain living order and its integrity, but it also carries with it the affirmation of eternity and eternal goods. At another point, he says, the notion of inert hope to me seems a contradiction in terms. Hope is not a kind of listless waiting. It underpins action or runs before it. It has affinities not with desire, but with the will. The will implies the same refusal to calculate possibilities, or at any rate suspends this calculation. And he talks about hope as not being something like the stoic stiffening of the will, but again, involving this relaxation, this openness to something else. Another really wonderful thing that he has to say about hope is that hope involves, oops, just lost a page thing. Here we go. Hope consists in asserting that there is at the heart of being, so in the ground of things, beyond all data, beyond all inventories and all calculations, a mysterious principle which is in connivance with me, which cannot but will that which I will, if what I will deserves to be willed, and is in fact willed by the whole of my being. So it's not something where, like, hoping, you know, thereby then...
I haven't a clue what that was about.
Okay.
I don't know what he's saying there.
Well, what is it that you don't understand about it?
Can you put that in your own words?
It's God's will may work things out for me.
Hope is the sort of commitment of a person to, whether it's going to happen or not, to saying that it's not just a cruel, hard cosmos that doesn't care at all about me or about things, but if my will is actually willing the right thing, they will cooperate with
me. I can see why him and Sartre didn't get along.
That's just one of many points.
I stopped at the word will. My will?
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean?
Your faculty of choice. You have a capacity.
It has to do with choice.
Well, you have a capacity to determine yourself and freedom.
Uh-huh.
You know, this is part of what it means to be a human being, is to be able. Sometimes it's only this little bit,
but
you can go this way or this way. And a lot of times, willing doesn't mean making a new choice. It means persevering in a choice that we've made. Mm-hmm. You know,
that's deep.
That's not me. That's Anselm and Epictetus and people like that.
I really don't believe in hope.
At all?
I believe that it's something that we have created over time, human beings have created over time, as a tool for our survival.
Yeah.
Just like religion.
All right,
that's how I feel about religion.
Part of the world of problematics.
If you have hope, then you will
keep struggling. It's a survival thing?
Yes, it's a survival
thing. Yeah, I mean, Marcel disagrees.
He's
not going to just reduce it to that. Then it would just be a function of the human being, and it would be the realm of problematics. And then, there are many philosophers who see things that way. The Spinoza that he's talking about would be one great example. A lot of classical treatments of emotions would kind of all put them on the same level, Even Thomas Aquinas, I think, does that, except insofar as he's treating it as a virtue. But they treat all the affects as being kind of on the same level. So whether it's anger, hope, fear, it's just an emotion, and it's just part of our thing. Marcel is taking a very different stance about emotions, and you'll see most personalist philosophers doing this, saying that some of the emotions actually tap into what's highest in our being. You know, they open us up to what's most real. Not bad emotions like anger.
No.
But, yeah.
Would he have equated hope with positive thinking?
No. You mean like the looking into the mirror and saying to yourself each day, every day in every way I'm becoming better and better and better?
No. Positive thinking. In the sense of looking at, let's say, if you have a leg injury, which makes it very difficult for you to walk, to think positively of your ability to locomote with the help of a crutch or a wheelchair or whatever, and focus on the way you are able to move rather than on the way you were unable to move.
Yeah. Does hope involve that? Yeah, I guess that would be part of the act of hoping.
Well, I mean, equating hope with will seems to me to be using positive thinking.
I didn't equate it with will. I said it's something that's of the will. Like any of these things that are, for Marcel, tying us into mystery, they don't have definitions.
Oh.
They have characterizations. And the more and more we think about them. But yeah, you're right. If in a case like that, being open to the positive possibilities, remaining open to them, would be part of what hope would look like.
Seems so passive.
Like I said, he says inert hope is a contradiction in terms.
That's passive. So you have to be. In other words, if you have hope, then you have to work at it.
You got to do something.
You have to involve yourself.
There's a difference between like waiting around for something to happen.
Like waiting for Godot.
Well, that's. I guess. I mean, they started to screw around through the whole play.
It never comes.
Well, yeah, they talk a lot of stuff to each other, and one punches the other.
Sometimes the dark side.
That's why I feel hope is part of a concept that keeps us surviving. I don't necessarily believe in it, but I understand it.
Marcel might be willing to say it certainly has that function. There's a lot of things where if you don't have hope, you won't take the actions that would be needed. Like, you know, one of these classic examples is, this actually happened. There was a guy who was caught in a snowstorm out in, you know...
Colorado.
I don't know if it was Colorado, but he... He thought he was really screwed, that this is it. You know, car's dying. And so what he did is he decided, I'm going to go as far as I can because I want to make sure that my body's found so that my wife will get an insurance payout. Because if there's no body, you know, maybe they just think I took off or something like that. So since I'm going to die anyway, I got to make sure that she's, you know, going to be provided for. And...
that makes so much sense.
Well, it does, and that's something I would do myself. But you know what ended up happening?
What?
He makes it to town.
He makes it.
And he makes it to town because he's not actually planning on trying to make it to town. He doesn't know where the hell he is. He doesn't know how far away he is.
It doesn't involve hope, though.
It does involve hope.
It doesn't involve the hope of survival.
Yes. It does involve the hope for something bigger. Which is that he's going to take care of his wife and children.
Well, he looked at it as that. Well, if I look at it, okay, I would have been, first of all, dead right on the spot because I'm not struggling for any of that. But the thing is, he looked at it as, I look at it as, okay, you know, there's probably no hope you're going to make it. But it really would be nice if I have, you know, if I had people I wanted.
Yeah.
So try it anyway because you're randomly, you may be the lucky one. It's not about hope. It's just about, I either want to just lay down, take it, if I had a pill, take it. Or there is a chance that I could leave a legacy by having my body found. Okay, but it wouldn't be on the basis
I bring it up here as an example because the way the guy actually describes it is the way I've portrayed it.
Serendipity.
Where he, in fact, intentionally set out with this plan, with the hope that his body would be found. Yeah. And because it fits into what Marcel is talking about. We can skew the story all sorts of other ways, but what the guy actually said about his motivation is what we've got. You know.
He was being logical about his life. Yeah. And
he's being logical in a way that a lot of other people wouldn't have done, though.
But
I mean, if it's just purely logical, then, you know, a lot of us would have just sat in the car and said, ah,
but
it is.
Really?
I don't know.
But it is positive. It is positive thinking, not simply sitting there and hoping that someone will find you.
Yes.
And the normal way we use the word hope would be the latter way of hoping that I'll be found and everything will work out.
I think that's the way a lot of people use hope.
Yes.
Marcel is very clear that...
He's not using it that way.
That hope involves an active comportment. Yes. And I think there have been many other people... Again, his goal is not to, like, you know, change the meaning of words. It's to reveal the meaning that has been there and has been lost quite often. Because there's many other people who talk about hope in active ways, too, throughout the history of philosophy. But let's talk very quickly about fidelity, and then we'll bring it to an end. So fidelity, he doesn't talk about faith, like, you know, I have to have faith in God or something like that. He talks about fidelity instead. And he doesn't talk much about fidelity to God. You know, he's much more interested in fidelity to other persons. It can involve, you know, the divine in some way. He says, faithfulness is the exact opposite of inert conformism. It is the active recognition of something permanent, not formally after the manner of a law, but ontologically in terms of being. It refers to a presence or to something which can be maintained within us and before us as a present, but which also can be just as well ignored, forgotten, and obliterated. So it's in a way to be faithful is to face up to the fact that at any given moment we could betray other people instead of being faithful.
Fidelity
sometimes... He has an example in one of his books about going to visit a sick friend and having this intention to visit him in a nursing home. And when he makes the commitment, he feels a sense of sort of attachment to his friend. And then he finds himself later on feeling just not feeling anything, but except feeling bad about that, you know. And mm-hmm. he says, you know, what did I commit to? Did I commit to just, I'm just going to show up mechanically and visit him? Is that all I was really committing to? No, I was committing to being there for my friend. And this is the most that I can actually bring. And maybe next time that I come, I'll be better. And he's considering, is that fidelity? Is that faithfulness?
Yeah. Well, the solution to that problem is don't overcommit yourself and make sure you let know, listen, I commit, I'll be there for you, but...
That doesn't help at all when you've already made a commitment, though. And we always find ourselves like in the middle of commitments that we've made, right? And then the question is, are we going to be faithful to them?
You commit to your beliefs and the follow-through of those beliefs.
Yeah, I guess Marcel says that faithfulness is ultimately not to beliefs and not to principles, it's to persons.
It's to people.
That's what he says.
It's and also to who you believe you are yourself, I would say.
In a way, you're deciding who you're going to be.
Yeah. So if you feel that you're a loyal person,
yeah.
The idea is fidelity is and be true to yourself because this is you. This is who you identify as yourself.
I don't know, though. Do you think that there's something... Do you think that if I make a commitment to you and I'm posed with should I follow through on it or not because things get difficult, and I say I want me to be the kind of person that I like me to be, so that's why I'm going to keep follow through on my commitment to you, rather than another way I could go is say, look, I made a commitment to you, you matter, and... If I get to think of myself as a good, loyal person, that's a bonus that comes with it. But really where my attention is on my commitment to you. Those seem to be very different, right?
Well, we have to look also that situations change over time.
Yeah.
Life's experiences change. So when you're making that commitment, you feel a certain way. And because of a lot of things that are happening, so as you mature, you have to look at that.
And
when we're younger, you say you love me, you're loyal to me, you better be for the next 100 years, otherwise you're not. We learn as we go on.
It's funny, too, because we you know, a lot of people who get married young, they have no idea what they're getting into. Yeah. And they have older people there to say, you have no idea what you're getting into, and they don't listen to them. And then they're, like, taking on the biggest, if you think about it just in terms of, like, time and readiness, they're taking on the huge commitment.
Yeah.
People who get married, you know, say when they're in, you know, midlife, right?
Yeah. It's a full-time job.
But we kind of knew what we were getting into a bit more than if we'd gotten married. Andy and I went to high school together. So we could have gotten married, like, right out of high school, right?
Sure.
And we would have had zero conception about what was coming up and all sorts of
and
crazy
And you hadn't
ideas.
Grown yet.
Right.
You hadn't grown as individuals.
I'm still growing.
So older people are in some ways better suited to get married, you know, and have a good shot at it than younger people are, if you think about it.
Oh, yes, most definitely. Most definitely.
Circumstances determine which direction you're going to take.
Yeah.
And it also depends on how how you were raised. I mean, people were raised to get married when you're young, and no matter how miserable you are, you stay married. I don't care if it's 100 years, and they have.
Well,
and they
divorce,
make the end.
Days. Divorce rate's over 50%.
No, but there was a time.
There was a time.
Yeah.
I'm glad I wasn't in
Well, someone asked me once how I could stay married to the same man for 56 years, and I said he was not the same man.
That's a great answer.
I think it's good to marry young and to learn how to stay, I mean... To learn about commitment.
Yeah.
I think commitment is a really important thing to feel about everyone in our lives.
Yeah, but if you don't know yourself when you're young, and you don't, you're shortening, you're depriving yourself of a full life.
There's probably some young people who
like,
are ready, and some young people who aren't.
No, I would not say I was ready. I got married at 17.
Wow.
But the point is, I grew...
Yeah,
and I didn't depend on my growth for his growth. I mean, each person has to find their own way of growing.
Yeah,
and the externals are really completely irrelevant to your own growth.
Oh,
but
I
you
don't
have
think
to
so.
You have to actually choose to to do that. And I think right. in your case, what you did is over and over again, you made choices.
That's right.
That you were going to do
my
things.
My father was married and divorced 4 times.
Wow.
And he basically was marrying, you know, again, his same problems.
Yeah.
You know.
That would be tough to do. To get married 4 times?
He had no trouble at all with
that. Oh, no, men like that. I love marriage. They love the ceremony. One friend of mine told me that. He's getting married the 3rd time. He says, I really like being married.
I think today the young people that are living together do much better than the ones that just at the early age get married.
I just kept getting girls pregnant, so I married.
3 times. You know, these examples and your description of Marcel's definition of faith also seem to me to differ from our normal definition of faith as being something passive, faith in what will be beyond our control, whereas here we're talking about faith as something active, fidelity as you describe it. But again, to me, Marcel abused the English language while saying he was determined to keep it pure.
Well, first,
well,
he wrote
in French.
French,
of course.
Yeah.
He did in French.
But he's not abusing it in any way.
Well,
and he's not
faith.
He's not
is a very important word.
Yes, and he's now think back to what he said about some words had become covered with you know sort of grease, and you want to strip that off of them. There's a lot of words where the verbal currency has become debased because people have turned faith, which was not. If you read people like Anselm, for example, he says, or you read St. Paul, faith without works is dead faith. You know, or that might actually be James. But this was not a new conception. He's just pulling us back to older conceptions that have been gradually covered over with detritus. And, you know, I think for a lot of this is a great example. You know, Catholicism in the 18th and 19th century in many areas was really moribund. Yeah. It had turned into something like a big system where everything's got its place and the lived reality of the faith had become something that it was lost. And a lot of these verbal significations come from that. And Marcel is totally reacting against that. You see this with a lot of converts that, you know, if they're gonna convert to it, it better have some vital living relevance to them, or why would they convert? And so with words like faith, hope, and charity, he thinks that it's not just like the secular culture that you know made them anemic, you might say. It was even the religious culture of the last couple centuries that had done a number on them, and now it was time to revitalize them. And a lot of people would, you know.
That's where I think fidelity, as he defines it, fits.
I mean, the person who probably get most angry about that would be like the parish priest who wants everything nice and simple, so the parishioners get in their pews and don't think about this. Who would be most upset about his, you know, changing the meaning of these terms? Because the atheists, they're not going to care, right? You can call it whatever you want, you know.
Does he cover this sort of discussion about fidelity, hope, and love in The Broken World? Would you say
play The Broken World?
Yes, is that?
I'm trying to
think of something to read of his that would give example.
So if I was going to just say read only one thing, I would get this book, The Philosophy of Existentialism. This was a set of essays, and it includes the ontological mystery. It also includes his criticism of Sartre, and it's even got a little autobiography in it. You can often find this at like used bookstores. This was the first stuff to be translated into English, and it was sort of the gateway into Marcel. And then if you had to pick another, there's an edition of The Broken World that has The Broken World followed by some commentary, because it's the play that he refers to the most. Uh-huh. And then if I had to just pick one other book, I would say being and having, which has, again, it's a bunch of stuff all put together.
Yeah. Did he win a Nobel Prize for that?
No, he won a bunch of other prizes.
Okay, there was one of
It's kind of funny. Towards the end of his life, he was like getting prize after prize.
Well, that always happens that way.
Yeah. The last guy, Camus, won.
Oh, Camus.
Camus would have gotten a lot more prizes if he'd lived longer.
Probably.
You know?
I love this.
Oh, okay.
You have someone to be at one that you don't know about.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm sorry, but we have to bring it to a close. So this is the end of our big lecture series thing, and you guys have been very patient.
Thank you.